Hi, everybody. The Blender Asset Browser is a new feature in Blender 3.0. It allows you to quickly browse your own libraries for saved objects, materials, poses, and much more. And then you simply drag and drop assets into your scene. This is a really big addition that many have wanted for a long time and that other 3D programs include. It's not an add-on. It's actually being built into Blender and it's free. I'll show you step by step how to get the asset browser, set up your asset library, and import assets into your scene really fast. The asset browser went through a lot of changes as it was developed in the alpha version, so if you've seen an earlier tutorial, it's probably already out of date. The asset browser is now available in the beta version of Blender 3.0. The full release is scheduled for December 2021. By the way, I realize I am going to say asset about 100 times in this video. Assets can include objects, materials, poses, images, and I believe much more to come. However, I'm going to focus on objects and materials for this tutorial. To use the asset browser, you need to have Blender 3.0. Go to blender.org/download. If you're watching this after the full release, just download version 3.0. If not, click on the tab that says Builds and look for Blender 3.0 Beta under whichever operating system you use. Download and install it. Make sure you open the 3.0 version of Blender if you still have an older version. It's important to note that this asset browser is just that, a browser and not a true library. It doesn't store assets, it simply points Blender to a location where it can find the asset. It then pulls assets from other Blend files stored on your computer. So you'll have to designate a folder or multiple folders on your computer to tell Blender where to look for assets you want available in the browser. If you've already got a well-organized folder system for your assets, that is awesome. If not, you should create a single file folder where you will store Blend files containing all of your assets. It can contain subfolders, that's fine, but nothing will appear in the browser that's not inside the designated overarching folder. To do this, go to Preferences, and under File Path, find the section titled Asset Libraries. Here you can add one or multiple libraries. If you already have a folder set up, you can choose that one, or you can create a new one, or you can use the default folder that Blender creates. Just make note of where it is saved on your computer. Give your library a name and select the file path to the folder containing your assets. For this example, I've created a folder called Asset Browser Test. Save your preferences. I'll navigate to the Asset Browser Test folder on my computer, and I will add a Blend file containing some human models I bought off of Blender Market. I'll open the file in Blender 3.0. Now, two things have to happen for these models to be available inside the asset browser. They need to be saved in a Blend file inside of a designated folder. We already did that part. Secondly, they need to be marked as an asset. They're not automatically available in the browser just because they're in the folder. This is because you might have many objects, materials, or other assets in a Blender file, but you only want some of them to show up in the asset browser. Select one or more objects in your Blend file. Go to the outliner and right-click on the selected models. Select Mark as Asset. You can mark multiple assets at the same time and you don't have to individually click each one. A side note, if an object is already marked as an asset, this option will be grayed out. If you want to remove an object from the browser, you can select Clear Asset from here. When an object is marked as an asset, you now see a new logo appear next to the object in the outliner, showing that it is a marked asset. I'll show you how this works with materials too. I'll create a cube, and then I'll add a new material to it. To add the material to the asset browser, right-click the material in the Material Properties panel, and Mark as Asset is an available option. We will stay in this file and take a look at the asset browser itself. The asset browser comes in the form of a new editor screen. We'll move this timeline editor up in the workspace. In the top left where you select your editors, you'll notice a new option called Asset Browser. Let's go over this new editor now. In the middle, we see the assets we marked are displayed. Blender creates really convenient preview images. Later, I'll show you how to change these preview images if you want. On the left, we have an area where we can navigate through our assets. We toggle the visibility of this with T. In toggles the right sidebar on and off. This is where you can view and change data for your selected assets. Back to the left side. This top drop-down box allows you to choose from different libraries. It defaults to current file, and this will show only assets marked in the file you are currently using. It shows the three models and the one material, which we marked as assets in this file. Clicking the drop-down box will show you whatever other library folders you have chosen in the file path preferences that we looked at earlier. This is showing a few other libraries I've set up, as well as the asset browser test folder I just made. The assets from this file also show up here because the current file is stored inside the asset browser test folder on my computer. Let's talk about organizing assets. The asset browser gives you a lot of flexibility in organizing how your assets display inside the browser, regardless of which blend file stores which assets. You may have dozens or more blend files with objects and materials that you want available, but they're all able to be organized however you want inside of the browser. Below the drop-down box on the left is an area that displays what are called catalogs. Within a selected library, you can have many catalogs. The two default catalogs are all and unassigned. Both are probably self-explanatory. Next to all, there is a plus sign. Clicking this will create a new catalog. We can double-click this and name it People. The asterisk next to the catalog tells us the file hasn't been saved since we created it, and closing without saving will lose the catalog. We can then go to either the all or the unassigned catalogs and drag the People assets into the People catalog. We see they no longer display in the unassigned catalog because they've now been assigned to the People catalog. We can click the plus sign next to the People catalog to create a subcatalog and call it Mails. We can then drag all the mail models into the mail catalog. Subcatalogs work a little differently than traditional subfolders. They're really more like filters than they are folders. Selecting People will show us all of the People models regardless of which subcatalog they're in. But selecting Mails will narrow it down to only the mail models. The arrow next to the catalogs will collapse and expand the subcatalogs. Right-clicking a catalog gives you some options, including to delete the catalog. You can drag catalogs into other catalogs. It's pretty easy to use, and it's really versatile. We'll press the plus sign next to all again and create a new catalog for materials. Let's drag the marked material asset into the materials catalog. Remember to save the file to save your catalogs. If the blend file has already been saved, you can also press the save icon next to the all catalog to save them all. I've got more, but if you've made it this far, consider giving the video a like because it really helps me out with the YouTube algorithm. Okay. Something really important to understand about the asset browser is that you can only move assets around in catalogs and change their metadata when you're inside the original blend file. Part of that metadata is the preview image. When I bought these models, they actually each came with individual preview images. Press In to toggle the Details tab on the right. It shows the preview image of the selected model. Clicking the folder icon next to it will let us navigate to whatever stored image we want to use as a preview model. Also, over here you can rename the asset, you can add a description and author, and we can add tags, which I assume will help find assets in a very large library, using this search bar up on top. Remember, you can only change this data and move assets into and out of catalogs when you're in the current file, meaning when you're actually in the blend file where the objects are stored. Now that we have a few objects in the browser, let's see how to pull objects from the browser into a new scene. And we'll close this file and open a brand new scene in Blender 3.0. We'll add a plane just so we have a surface to place objects onto. Expand a window and open up the asset browser editor. No assets display. That's because it defaults to the current file library. Remember, the current file refers to the file that you have open right now. And this file doesn't have any marked assets. When we change from current file to the asset test library that we set up earlier, we see our assets displayed. And now the best part. Drag one of the models from the asset library over the plane. It projects a little grid to show you where it's going to land. Drop the model onto the plane and it snaps to it. So what just happened when we did this? To Blender, this preview image represents a specific object inside of a specific blend file inside of a specific folder on my computer. With one drag, we told Blender to go to that file, append the object, and place it where we just dragged our cursor to. It's not the most complicated thing in the world, but it's a very powerful tool now inside of Blender that doesn't take up a ton of extra storage. Now we can just keep dragging and dropping assets as much as we want. Simply drag the material onto the cube and it applies it. This was a game changer for me. One more important thing. Top and center of the asset browser is another drop-down box which determines how we input the asset into our scene. There are now three options, there used to only be two. The default is Append Reuse Data. This appends the object from the original file, but if we drag the same object into the scene multiple times, they will share data with each other. Editing one of these objects will edit all instances of the object in the scene. Don't worry, editing an object here does not affect it in its original file location. I tested that just to make sure. This is generally probably the best way to import assets because it saves on the amount of data being stored. It's especially good if you're going to have tons of the same object all over your scene. But let's say we want to bring this model into the scene twice, but then we want to edit one of the objects without affecting the other. Well, we can change the import option to append, and it'll bring in another instance of the object with its own independent set of data. Now we can change this object without it affecting the other objects in the scene. The third option is link, but when you link an object into your scene, you can't change it or even move it. It has to be changed and moved in the original file location, which to me seems pretty useless for most cases. So that's most of what there is to know about the asset library. Let me just show you one of the libraries I've been putting together. I've got a couple hundred objects in it, dozens of materials, and I've created a lot of catalogs to organize it. I do notice it lags a little when I'm in a catalog with lots of assets, but it's not that bad. The search function works really well, and I've been really happy with it overall. It does take some time to get all your assets organized and available in the browser, but I think the time is a good investment. You have a lot of control how you organize things. I might consider breaking the larger library into some smaller ones, but we'll see. Now remember, Blender 3.0 is still in beta testing, so there are definitely bugs that probably still need to be worked out. So be careful to save your work regularly when using the beta version. It's also possible the developers might make further changes to how the browser looks or functions before its official release. My name is Brandon, and I'm just a guy who likes to use Blender. I would love to have you as a subscriber to my channel or a follower on my Instagram.